tuning into Magic TV. I am Tristan Shaun Gregson here with Luis Scott-Vargas. Seems like we've been a little while since we've sat down. You were off playing some Legacy or testing for Nationals.
Yeah. I ended up playing Legacy. Columbus didn't go too well. I mean, it didn't make day two, but pretty much everyone else playing the same deck did, so at least the deck was good.
Credit where credit is due, right?
I mean, it wasn't my deck. It was just a deck that we all tested.
It was a team deck.
Right.
The team deck.
Martel made the finals, so that was good.
With the four-color countertop deck that you guys worked on? Okay. Sounds good. Right now, we are the week after Gen Con.
Right.
And to me, like, we could do this show without mentioning Gen Con, in my opinion. We could pretend it didn't exist, because it seems like a lot of people do that. But to me, it's like Wizards put a lot of energy into...
When you say Gen Con, you mean, like, which, like, Gen Con as a whole, or specific tournaments at Gen Con?
I think that, obviously, we're here for the Magic-related portion of Gen Con.
Right.
That being Wizard-sponsored events, and what a lot of people think of, or at least what I think of when I look at their coverage, is the Vintage Championships.
Yeah.
Again, I mentioned it to you, and it was like, do you think that's Vintage Championships, the tournament that they run there? Would you think that's an accurate representation?
No, I mean, I don't think most people consider it, like, actual Vintage Champs, because the fact is it's a 115 or 117-person tournament, you know, and it's been less before, and you're missing a lot of the people who would need to be at Vintage Champs. Like, there are very few Europeans, you know, like, no one from the West Coast goes. Me, Matt Sperling, David Ochoa, like, none of us go. And, I mean, the problem is there's not enough attendance, really, to call it Vintage Champs for real. So, I mean, it's better than not having anything, but it's not exactly what I would call a championship.
I really feel like Vintage itself is kind of a subculture of Magic, where if you play it, you're in the know. Like, you could say to me, you know, it's not the Vintage Championships, and everyone who plays knows. And I was like, as a Magic player who's not a entrenched in Vintage, it's like, well, who are these people? Like, I don't necessarily know, but it definitely seems like they're a subculture. And
yeah, Vintage is just not that big, and most of the people, between the mana drain and tournament results, they know who the other people in Vintage are, and just because understandably, I guess, there's not enough prize support at Gen Con to really make it attractive enough for people like from Europe to justify going. But I mean, Europe routinely has 300 plus person Vintage tournaments. Calling those Vintage Worlds would be more accurate than calling Gen Con. Like, I think Gen Con should be like, you know, the Gen Con Vintage Championships, not the Vintage World Championships. That's a somewhat misleading name.
Championship to challenge, and I'm fine with whatever they do. Mm. I think when you tack on that word where it's like, this is the best and it's come together and this is the deck that won it, I think you're putting a lot, you're trying to say a lot in a 100-person tournament versus a 300-person tournament. And you mentioned Europe, and I remember when you had the Grand Prix in Madrid earlier this year. Europeans are all about real Magic cards and playing old cards.
Yeah, the side event at the Grand Prix, not even like a big Vintage tournament, just like the Vintage side event that ran on Sunday, got like over 200 people, you know, and no proxies.
And I don't know what won that tournament. I'd really like to know what won that tournament versus what won...
It was probably workshops, because they like workshops out there, but like the side event at Nationals last year was like 20 people. So
The Grand Prix in Oakland that I played, I think it was under 20.
Yeah.
So that was a little bit disappointing for Vintage. Wizards supports Gen Con not just as a booth, not just as being a vendor there, but it seems like they have tournament coverage, they try to bring a lot to it, but there's not stacking up for Vintage.
Well, I mean, the thing is, like, Gen Con is an awesome, convention. I've never had a chance to go. I wish I had. Like, I'd like to go at some point, but the fact is, when I take a look at the tournaments I'm going to attend in a given year, Gen Con just can't compete with a Grand Prix or a Pro Tour. And at this point, that's pretty much all I travel for is a Grand Prix or a Pro Tour.
So the immediate question to me is, what would it take to get you, Webb, Sperling, Europeans to show up at...
Well, me, Webb, and Sperling would unquestionably go if there was Pro Points involved. I can understand why they don't do that. Giving away Pro Points for a sanctioned format where not everyone can play the deck they want to play, that's not very fair. It's pretty unfair to people who don't own all the Vintage cards. They could up the prizes, but again, with the attendance they get, it's kind of hard for them to justify upping the prizes too much. I mean, especially since, as is, the original art that goes first is worth a couple $1,000, from what I heard. But I think the fact is the Vintage community is, you know, it's so separated between Europe and the United States and Japan. Like, the last year's winner actually came from Japan. So In order to bring all those together, you have to offer enough incentives for the people who, you know, live far away from the tournament to travel there. And I don't know if there's really the budget to do that, like, both because vintage players, you know, aren't a huge segment of the population, and because I'm not sure what the interest is in for, like, coverage, for example. So that's just, like, the reality of the situation. But, I mean, calling it Vintage World Championships is not something that I think a lot of people are happy with. I know, just looking at the thread on the manager, and the Europeans do not seem to like the fact that, you know, it's called the Vintage World Championships, and they essentially don't get to play because, you know, it costs $2,000 or whatever for them. There are $1,000 for them to go play.
No, what you're saying makes sense. So, I mean, it's not a Wizards-supported format because card pool is so... card pool might be the largest card pool you could draw from, but the number of cards is very small that people can actually get their hands on. And it's interesting to think about a tournament that would have pro points where not everyone attending would have an easy time getting cards.
And you just can't do that. I don't think that's fair. I honestly don't think Magic should be about, you know, who can afford the cards, or people should make deck decisions based on card availability. And, you know, I think giving away pro points under that circumstance would just be terrible. So as much as it would help me, because I love Vintage, would love to play it for actual stakes and, you know, have the cards, I still don't think it would be fair to everyone, and so I would be against that, I guess.
Yeah. To me, what was funny was when Webb, the Ocho, Dave Ocho, for those of you who don't familiar with all of his names, was talking about it. I mean, he, for starters, I think he actually was involved in one way or another in the deck that won it, correct?
He came up with the deck, actually, because the deck is, I mean, the deck is like a Tezzeret base, which... wasn't like, you know, a lot of people had that deck, you know, it was pretty obvious. But what he did is add Dark Confidants and Trigon Predators to it, and, you know, no one else had really done that. And he won a tournament here, and then it did well in another tournament. And the two finalists, you know, the Dark Confidant himself, Bob Marr, and Owen Turtenwald, both were playing a deck with Bob's Trigons. They ended up cutting the Tezzeret for a Jace and adding red for Red Elemental Blast. But Webb said the difference between in the main deck was like two cards, and the difference on the sideboard was like four cards or something.
So now, if you think Trigon Tez, you definitely think Webb.
Yeah, I mean,
I did when I lost to it.
Yeah, he's the one who came up with it, you know. So yeah, I mean, it's a shame that the guy who built the deck, you know, the deck that was both in both sides of the finals, just didn't go to the tournament because he just didn't feel it was worth his time.
Which was the second part of what I was getting to, which was like finding incentive to get players like yourselves to go to this event is really hard. And it seems like as much as you guys like Vintage, it's definitely recreational. It's not part of
I'm under no illusions that you know, Vintage is ever going to be a Grand Prix format. So I'm never going to need to know how to play Vintage to compete, you know, at a Pro Tour or Grand Prix. I think Vintage does make you better at Magic. I mean, playing any sort of Magic makes you better at Magic. I've said this a lot. Like, even playing Cube, you know, playing Vintage, playing Pauper, like, they get you thinking about Magic in different ways than you normally do, and that actually helps. That helps you, you know, improve your gameplay for other situations. I know if you are interested in Legacy, playing Vintage is, you know, use a lot of the same skills, like how to brainstorm, how to force a will, how to play around Wasteland, that sort of thing. But, yeah, I mean... both Webb and I love Vintage, but know that it's not like an actual format that matters for, you know, the Player of the Year sort of thing or Pro Tours. And so that being said, you know, when we've got all these tournaments, it's really hard for people, you know, us to figure out a way to go to Gen Con because, you know, there's Gen Con, you know, this week, and then like 3 weeks later is Nationals, and then the week after Nationals is Gothenburg, then Amsterdam, then Portland, so four tournaments in a row. So me being gone for all those tournaments made it really hard for me to justify going to Gen Con, so I didn't. And other people have different reasons not to go, and money is a valid reason. Like, it's the reason that a lot of Europeans or, you know, Japanese wouldn't go to Gen Con normally. And it's the reason why a lot of people from the West Coast wouldn't go. Like, I'm sure there's plenty of people from out here who play our Vintage tournaments who would love to play at Vintage Champs, but, you know, spending $400 on a plane ticket or $300 or whatever, plus hotel room, plus, you know, Gen Con badge or whatever, it adds up, and it just ends up being too much to play in, like, the one tournament.
All of that just for Europe to not even acknowledge you. That seems like... nothing I would be interested in. Because that's what I look for. I want that recognition. If I can't get it.
You want to be the Vintage champion.
And I want the message boards to at least 50%.
Yeah.
You can agree with that.
Yeah, and the fact is, I don't know what the solution is. It's unfortunate, but I mean, I would rather have Vintage Champs than no Vintage Champs, even if it's called Vintage Champs. Even though the name isn't accurate, I think the tournament's, you know, a good thing. So. A lot of talk about why it doesn't work and no real solutions, but I guess that's what we got for this.
Yeah, it's interesting. Vintage is so hard to manage. I mean, you yourself saying it shouldn't be a format the pros play, that's a big deal to me. It's a format we both love. But that's it. It's just love. It's not really, like, competitive in a nature where you're going to play it.
Yeah. All right. Well, thanks for watching and tune in with suggestions on how they could improve Vintage Champs, I guess.
Yeah.
Since we don't know.